My very great pleasure to introduce somebody who knows this place very well indeed. As you can see from the screen, Mark is the Director of Studies here at the mighty Paul Mellon Centre. Before he was at the Paul Mellon, he was the Head of Department at the History of Art at the University of York, also Professor there. And I think I'm right in saying that under Mark's leadership and since, it's become very much a powerhouse for art history, the department in the University of York. My PhD was there, so I'm contracted to say. But no, it's honestly, it's an excellent department. I think it very much kick-started as this powerhouse under Mark himself. Now, Mark covers a sizable chunk of British art history. 1650 to 1850 is the main focus, I think I'm right in saying. Over the years, he's written that magnificent volume on Reynolds, which I'm sure you all have at home. And also, but way back earlier than that, he did a great book, which I'm now reading again, on Hogarth's satirical prints and engravings, which I think is an excellent book, and I'm reading it now because of the particular focus on Hogarth. He also led and coordinated an extraordinary project in conjunction with the RA's 200th anniversary, which I'm sure you've all seen. If you haven't, look at this chronicle, the Royal Academy Chronicle, 250 years, a magnificent and massive project, which I think is always worth dipping into. It's just a great piece of scholarship, but also an extraordinary project in its own right, and the accompanying exhibition at the RA, which you probably saw. He's also now venturing into contemporary and modern art. Somebody has to. And he's, for example, curated the show George Shaw. Somebody completely different. I'll do the jaunty ditty in a minute. But George Shaw at the Holborn, which obviously toured to Yale as well. So he does, he's a not just a jack of all trades, he's a sort of master of all trades and periods in British art history. So tonight he's going back to his usual stomping ground, and a slight change of theme. The theme's still there, art and war, but we're now looking at Georgian panorama, military history, military art, and the Georgian panorama. Thanks. Over to Mark.
Thanks very much indeed, Jackie. Yeah. I thought I'd try and do a talk that stretched one hand back to Jackie's talk last week and her focus on the March to Finchley, which the picture which we focused on so intently last week, and also reach forward at its end to next week's talk, which Christine Riding is going to be giving on the fight in Temeraya. And that's, in a sense, covering the entire Georgian period. And for our purposes tonight, what's really distinctive and relevant, I think, is that that was a period that saw three major conflicts for Britain. First, the Seven Years' War between 1756 and 1763, in which in many ways Britain established its first major empire. A conflict which began with great doubts and anxieties about Britain's capacity to win that war, but ended with victory. Then we have the Wars of the American Revolution, or the, what's the official title, but the Wars of American Independence. And that ran from 1775 right through to 1783. And that had a very, very different trajectory in history, of course, for Britain. It's a conflict out of which she emerged having been defeated and having lost a sizable chunk of her empire and the American colonies. It felt in many ways like a civil war in which part of Britain's own internal fabric had been ripped away from her. So there was a great sense of disappointment and anger in the aftermath of that conflict. And then, to end, and I'll be touching on this towards the end of this talk, Britain was involved in the Revolutionary and Napoleonic Wars, of course, from the early 1790s right through to Waterloo, the victory at Waterloo, which saw Britain finally emerging out of this long and protracted and difficult conflict, victorious, and on the brink of being able to expand into the great 19th century imperial nation that we know from the Victorian period. So there's three major conflicts, all of which involved Britain fighting against France, and which characterized much of the period that I'm going to be focusing on. The other thing that I wanted to talk about for this, or to put in your minds in relation to this period and context for my talk tonight, is the fact that this period also saw the emergence of Britain's exhibition culture in the world of art. The first ever contemporary exhibitions, annual exhibitions of contemporary British painting took place from the 1760s onwards. And the Royal Academy was founded in the late 1760s. And then after that, we get this explosion of an exhibition culture where not only the Royal Academy exhibitions were becoming larger and larger and more important, but numerous artists were setting up their own exhibitions with individual paintings within them. And what's interesting is if you actually explore that exhibition culture, if you read the chronicle that Jackie just mentioned, if you look through the exhibition catalogues for the period I'm going to be dealing with, you'll find that the imagery of war features very, very powerfully and strongly throughout the exhibition culture of the Georgian period. And you see artists both emphasising the heroism of war, the bravery and courage of the soldiers, especially the officers, typically in the paintings that we'll be looking at, but also, interestingly, exploring the horrors and the melancholy and the pity the tragedy of war. So I think we'll be touching on all of those issues in the talk tonight. So we've finished last week with William Hogarth and the March of the Guards to Finchley. Our first port of call is another artist, Joshua Reynolds. And this is a self-portrait from just three or so years before Hogarth produced that portrait, a picture you looked at last week. Very interesting self-portrait, just before he goes off to Italy, in which it's been speculated that he's gazing forward into a future which would include this tour specifically. And you see him already playing very dramatically with light and shade in his painting, in a way that he was to do throughout his career. But the painting I'd like to focus on to begin with is a painting that he painted in 1756. So right at the beginning of that conflict I was mentioning, the Seven Years' War, and right at the moment when that conflict was looming. In fact, the scene that Reynolds depicts, we'll find out, is actually set in 1755. And it's a scene which ended up exposing many of the anxieties that Britain had about its status and about its potential fortunes against France in a war that everyone knew was looming. And it's interesting, this painting hangs in the National Gallery, and just it brackets with another painting that we'll be looking at later, the great room of 18th and early 19th century British paintings at the National Gallery, and you may well have walked past it many times. And assumed it depicted a heroic soldier standing in a rather shadowy, darkened setting. You may not have noticed that in the background, especially if you go and look at it in the flesh, you'll see the smoke and the arising from a battlefield, and you actually see flecks of red, which seem to indicate the soldiers' uniforms of figures in the far distance. And what we actually find out when we do some research on this image is that it actually depicts not a moment of great victory, but a moment of traumatic defeat, and in fact a massacre, or the aftermath of a massacre. And this massacre took place in 1755 in North America, and it featured 2,000 British and American troops who were on a mission walking through the forests of North America to relieve a fort that had been captured by the French. And while they were going through the forest in strict and rather rigid military formation, they realised soon after they were deep into the forest that they were being followed. And it's really haunting to read the accounts by the actual participants of this search party, or this 2,000 strong group of soldiers going deep into the forest in America. And what started happening over successive evenings is that they realised that they would lose one or two figures from their group. They would just disappear. In the mornings, their scalps would be hung on the trees. And so actually, it was a kind of cumulative thing where increasingly the soldiers, especially the ordinary soldiers, would become increasingly freaked out, essentially, by the experience of going deep into this unfamiliar territory. And then suddenly, one morning, they were ambushed. And essentially, there was a massacre. Hundreds of British soldiers were killed. And rather than keeping to their formation, keeping to their military discipline, what actually happened was that for the great majority of the troops, ran away to escape, rather than fighting against this combination of French and Native American soldiers and warriors who had attacked them. It was a terrible, calamitous defeat. People wrote about soldiers ripping their own clothes off as they ran to somehow make themselves, disguise themselves as they ran into the forest. There was a lot of praise for the bravery of some of the officers who didn't run away and did try and fight back. Many of them were killed, including the commanding officer, General Braddock. And there's an image here of Braddock, General Edward Braddock, who led this form of the army, being shot. He was shot five times on his horse, falling off his horse. This is an illustration to a magazine of the period. And you can see the battle raging in the background. And interestingly, Orme, who we'll be seeing here, was Braddock's aide-de-camp. He was his assistant and junior officer who assisted the general, and had watched his general die, and was one of the few survivors from the officers to make it back to safety, and eventually back to Britain. And in the when the news of this massacre started seeping back into London in August 1755, it was seen to portend the potential defeat of Britain against the French, the sense that Britain had collapsed so calamitously in this conflict. The general had been defeated, and that British military discipline had broken down, and that the soldiers had fled in the way that was being described. It also conjured up a new image of America for poets and writers of the time. And this poem that's on the left there, it was written in the immediate aftermath of the news coming through, where someone wrote about the fact that no longer could they write about America, the American landscape and forest, in a positive way. It had to suddenly become seen as a dark and tragic place. No more I'll paint in soft descriptive strain the lofty mountain or the sunny plain, nor vernal meadow nor embowering grove, once the known seats of innocence and love. But now pale terror haunts the secret shade, and hostile bands each wished retreat invade. Review Monongahela, that's the river where this massacre took place, fatal flood, and reeking banks yet moist with British blood. Orme came back to London, and in the face of a lot of huge amounts of criticism of both Braddock and the troops, tried to promote a new image, a counter-narrative of the conflict, which emphasised the bravery of the English officers themselves. And I think that, and as part of that campaign in a way, Reynolds was on a speculative, this was never delivered to Orme, we're not entirely sure who bought it, or whether Reynolds painted it as a speculative portrait or a form of advertisement that he could hang in his studio to show what he could do with portraiture. And crucially, Reynolds was very keen to find ways of making portraiture do the kinds of work that history painting often did in the past. That is, tell stories about both the tragedy and the heroism of human society and conflict, and to tell intricate, complex stories about the figures he painted. And Orme, clearly, he saw Orme as a really fascinating subject for such a portrait, because he's someone who was there promoting that notion through writings, actually, he published in the press. It's very interesting. It's as if he's got a piece of paper in his hand to give to us to read, which tells the story of the conflict that's in the distance, the conceit of the painting that he might be delivering orders to a commander. But also someone who had been participated in this dark and tragic and horrendous barbaric event. And Reynolds seems interested in trying to capture both the heroism and the tragedy of that event. And I think it does so in lots of ways, but one of the most interesting ways is in the ways in which he paints Orme's face. And I did there's a little way in which that can be dramatized a little bit by showing one half of his face, this half, and seeing someone who seems on the face of it, or the half faces of it. This seems to me to express a much more confident, authoritative image of the English army officer, the kind of image that would be reassuring as an image of fortitude and resilience and confidence. There even seems to be the play of a smile on that mouth. But it's fascinating, if you turn to the other side of Orme's face, you see someone who looks very, very different indeed, and it's as if someone who really has been through a catastrophe and through a horrendous experience. And it's very fascinating how, if you shuttle back and forth, even the arm, the hair, the hat, the eyes, the mouth, the downturned mouth this time, rather than one that seems to have a hint of a smile, is brought into this image. So and of course, this is the dark and shadowed side of Orme's face rather than the illuminated, bright side. And so you can see here that Reynolds seems to be wanting to tell a story about fortitude and heroism, yes, but also an imagery that in combination captures both the, as I said, the bravery, but also the tragedy of that day. And so we see portraiture doing some quite complex things in response to the kinds of conflict that Britain found itself in at the beginning of the Seven Years' War. Now, the war, of course, was a great success, as I said. By the time we get to 1761, when this was first exhibited, it was painted in 1756, hung in Reynolds' studio for a number of years, and then he actually sent it to an exhibition alongside a very dramatically confident portrait of a military general to the second exhibition, one of the very early exhibitions taking place in London. And actually, there it seems to have been reread in a more positive way than the way I suggested, as an image of heroism, and the darker narratives, as it were, fading into the distance in the context of this great victory that was already, by 1761, clear was going to be the case. And then what's interesting is that in the aftermath of the conflict, artists like Reynolds and his contemporaries were needing to find a way in which to emphasize here not so much heroism, yes, and not so much tragedy, because this would have been such a great victory, but a new combination, a combination of military valor and bravery. Yes, that's a classic component of this military portrait that Reynolds produces, but also another quality that was going to be essential in the way that Britain promoted itself in the aftermath of the Seven Years' War. That is of benevolence, of mercy. The idea that we have a new empire, but we are benevolent leaders of that empire. We're not going to be cruel tyrants or dictators or oppressors of the peoples of territories that we've occupied and invaded. We are going to be enlightened, tolerant, merciful commanders. And Reynolds' portraiture seems to reflect that change, that new combination of heroism and mercy. A particularly interesting example of a painting he exhibits in 1766, 3 years after the end of the war, of this person, Sir Geoffrey Amherst. Now, Amherst was famous for having led British troops in Canada and for having taken the city of Montreal without a single British life, and I think actually a single opponent's life, being lost. It was done through strategy and tactics and surprise, but he was famous for, as I said, managed to win a great victory without having shed great amounts of blood. He was really respected for his tactical acumen and for his negotiation of this river. This is the St. Lawrence River. And it's interesting, here you see Reynolds depicting Amherst as if surveying the scene in which you see boatloads of troops heading up towards Montreal, where they would surprise, ambush, and take the city and win it for the British and for the British, the emergent British Empire. Interesting, this is a painting that, as I said, painted a number of years after the conflict. The conflict, this took place in 1760, it was painted in 1765, and in that interim time, Amherst had been awarded the Order of the Bath, which is that pink stripe that you see, that pink band that's on his... So it's interesting, he's set back in the landscape in Canada in 1760, and yet he's bearing the sash that shows one of the awards he was given in the aftermath of the war by the government for his services to the nation. And what's interesting about this is, to me, is this combination of military and martial values with something that seems to suggest something more gentle and sensitive. And this was picked up by contemporaries, as we'll see. But even us, I think, looking at it, can see the ways in which you get this combination of armour and the armoured body, which references back to Van Dyck's painting of numerous aristocrats and aristocratic officers in such uniform in the 17th century, and something which seems more gentle. It's interesting to note, for instance, that the gloved hand which leans or grasps the baton of the general's baton is contrasted with the ungloved hand that kind of unfurls, and in which Amherst rests his head and has this expression that you can read either as concentrated and focused on the job in hand, or as something more sensitive and more gentle. And I say that, but it's also something, as I said, that was picked up in the period. But before just turning to that reading of the image or rereading of the image, it's interesting to note that in the contemporary world, in the press and in contemporary paintings, just before Reynolds painted this picture, Amherst was being dramatized as someone who had shown mercy to those he'd occupied. There's a story of him going into a village where everyone in the village was terrified of the reprisals they would suffer from, not so much from the British troops, but from their Native American accomplices or fellow soldiers. And Amherst supposedly went in and reassured the inhabitants that everything would be fine, they would be looked after by a beneficent and generous English army. And this is an image, a modello for a much larger painting that actually hung in Vauxhall Gardens, which shows Amherst greeting the inhabitants of a village. And one contemporary account talks about the tender manner in which he spoke to them, which melted me before I was aware. This is supposedly a report from a fellow officer who stood there watching Amherst as he interacted with the villagers. I was aware, but on looking around, I found all the spectators in the same condition. Here was a grandfather presenting his numerous offspring to the general, a mother with a child at her breast and two or three at her knee, bawling and crying. The general ordered victuals and drink for them. A large fire was made before his tent, and they all sat around. That idea of bringing the occupied territories into a sense of safety and reassurance. So Amherst had this dual imagery of being a great military commander and a great tactician, but also someone who displayed great mercy and tenderness in his dealings with the local inhabitants. And it's interesting, in this painting, the eventual painting had an inscription on a stone that was in the foreground. And the inscription said, "Power exerted, conquest obtained, mercy shown." That's a lovely, I mean, not lovely, but that's the, I mean, it's all, of course, kind of propaganda and so on. But that's the imagery that was being promoted about both Amherst and about the British imperial state in the aftermath of the war. And what's really fascinating is that there's a poem, the only poem that someone wrote in the period, which describes watching Reynolds paint a painting. And that poem, or the poet, William Combe, he was called, it's an epistle to Joshua Reynolds, it was written a few years later, he remembers watching this portrait of Amherst, the portrait of Amherst, emerging on the canvas and seeing it take shape on the canvas. And he writes about the experience of watching and looking at Reynolds painting the portrait, which is almost a unique thing, especially in relation to Reynolds' painting. And that's the painting. And this is the first, these are the first lines of the poem. This is about watching it, first of all, emerge and seeing the final, and coming then to see the final image. "I saw your daring pencil trace the manly lines of Amherst's face. And as I stood, my wondering eyes beheld a heroic form arise," that idea of a heroic image of Amherst. "A deep and solemn look he wore, as if attentive to explore some dark design of Britain's foe, how to prevent the approaching blow, to stop the fury in its course or hurl it back with triple force." They're very much the imagery of the soldier, the tactician, anticipating the enemy's moves and having to really focus, in a sense that complements that dark cloud behind him. But what's fascinating is that the poem suddenly changes tack, the writer changes tack. Looking at that face and that expression, he changes and says, well, yes, it can show all of these things, or what in truth so far exceeds the highest fame of warlike deeds, humanely thoughtful how to save the starving thousands from the grave. So it's really interesting. He reads the expression, this poet in the period reads it as expressing both the tactical foresight of the soldier, thinking about how he's going to fight the fury that he faces, and then Riche reads it in relation to this much more tender and merciful sense of how he's going to spare the thousands of people who could potentially die in a great siege of Montreal from the grave. And finally, the poet writes about the way in which Reynolds' portrait manages to catch the generous, gentle grace that o'er the veteran features ran and marked the hero and the man. So this idea that you're fusing heroism and the man, or the private self, or the more tender self, into a single portrait. And it's really interesting if you actually return to the portrait and look at its various components. It's almost as if you can read upwards from that very aggressive or very authoritative imagery of its lower band. It's even the lower third of the painting. And you'll see here that this is as if it, remember that power exerted, what was it, conquest obtained, mercy shown. Well, look, the lower third of the image, that helmet standing on top of a map of the territory is a symbol, of course, of Britain's occupation of that territory and its military control and stranglehold over that same river that you see floating up in the background. We talked about the glove. We talked about the baton. Look at the way in which the general's baton is holding down, pinning down the territory in a very authoritative, aggressive way. It's quite interesting. Of course, conquest was obtained, and that was, and his rewards for such was that great band and the star that you see pinned to his chest. So let's say that's the middle part of the painting. And then finally, we might say that that face also shows mercy shown. So we go from all those different aspects of the story of Amherst and the story of the occupation. I think Reynolds is trying to capture in his image. And you can see it being captured almost in the journey that you can take up that baton, across the knuckled, gloved fist, along the armoured right forearm, across that cuff. And then suddenly you are into this much more interesting open territory of the hand and the face, and something, as I said, that can be read more gently, as well as in relation to more traditional images of manly, martial, heroism. Now, this is 1766, and in the aftermath, this was shown in a Society of Artists exhibition, and at the end of that decade, as I mentioned, the exhibition culture at the Royal Academy really started expanding. And this is the first ever image of an exhibition in a contemporary exhibition in Britain. It was taken, as you see, from it was an engraving or a print, a slightly satirical print, but quite an accurate depiction of the exhibition, the Royal Academy exhibition of 1771. Now, interestingly, in that same year, there was exhibited a painting that really made a huge impact in the exhibition culture of the day and in the history of British art. And that's Benjamin West's Death of Wolfe. So another famous military portrait or painting. And in fact, it's interesting, many people have talked about it in relation to a contemporary history painting. I think that's right. But let's also think of it as a group portrait. We talked about Orme and Amherst as portraits in relation to the battlefield. Here we have something that is both a grandiose history painting showing the moment when General Wolfe, this time the commander of British troops taking Quebec, dies at the moment that the victory is reached in the conflicts against the French and the, in Quebec. And you see him surrounded by his fellow officers and being looked down at and gazed at and tenderly held by his fellow men. Now, what's interesting here, it has been talked about in relation to contemporary history painting. That's entirely right. And just a few years beforehand, for instance, you find an artist like Gavin Hamilton producing something which is much more conventionally history painting. History paintings typically showed the great events of literature, the past, history, the Bible, rather than contemporary events. And they certainly didn't show figures dressed in contemporary dress. And so a much more conventional, although an amazing image in its own right, history painting, but one I think that's got fascinating parallels with West's work is Gavin Hamilton's Achilles lamenting the death of Patroclus, a great narrative from the Iliad, this time of fellowship and friendship and tragedy, the dying of Patroclus in Achilles' arms. And you can see that this kind of scene, a tragic death scene in which a dying figure is surrounded by mourning sympathisers, was a staple of history painting. What West does in many ways is translate it into modern form, into a form that exhibition goers going to the exhibition in London in 1771 will be able to recognise. That's something that happened relatively recently. That's someone we know about, General Wolfe. Those are people dressed in dress that we know about. It was a more accessible, open kind of imagery compared to the more learned traditions of history painting. And so it fused the conventions, the pictorial conventions of that older genre with something that felt much more modern and much more accessible. And of course, as well as drawing on the examples of artists like Hamilton and the classical narratives of texts like the Iliad, of course, West was also drawing on religious imagery and converting the death wolf himself into a kind of saintly or even Christ-like figure, who you can see is someone who is pictured in ways that are so deliberately resonant of older images of the dying Christ, and or the dead Christ. And what's fascinating here is that West wants to be both seen as a fine artist, working within the traditions of the great artists of the past and the great conventions of the past, at the same time as producing a product, a commodity that will work for a modern audience in late 18th century London. And part of that commodification, if we want to call it that, the turning art into something that's much more explicitly marketable, was the fact that paintings like this were very quickly turned into prints. And famously, West's painting of Wolfe was turned into one of the great success stories of print culture in the 18th century. William Woollett's great engraving after West's painting, The Death of Wolfe. So this model of showcasing a painting in the exhibition space that was both resonantly high art or fine art in its tradition, in its pictorial language, but also accessible and immediate and dramatic, was taken up and then translated into print culture, was taken up by a host of other artists subsequently. And probably the most famous and successful of them all was an American artist called John Singleton Copley, with a painting like this. So have a look at that for a second while my throat's getting a bit dry. So yeah, this painting is The Death of Major Pearson. It hangs at Tate Britain. Christine has actually hung it many times and decided which height it should take, and it's quite interesting to think about the height it should be displayed at. And it's a painting that's a great centrepiece of the display, 18th century display at Tate Britain. So please go and look at it, and that's very much what you're expected to do. And it was painted, as I said, between 1782 and 84, and this time relates to a conflict in that second, or a battle, or a moment, an episode in that second conflict I mentioned, the wars. It relates to the wars in America. This time, again, the wars against France in that period, And the French troops occupied Jersey in 1781, a band of French troops, and caught the commander, someone called Moisey Corbett. I think it's literally in his bed. And he surrendered instantly and capitulated to the occupying army in Jersey. And famously, he was disobeyed by a young army officer called Major Francis Pearson, who, as I said, disobeyed with a number of other officers the orders of his commander. They were meant to be surrendering. And instead, organized the troops to fight back against the occupying army. And in fact, won a victory over them and defeated them. And once again reoccupied the island for the British. But in doing so, just like Wolfe, was shot and died, not around the culmination or the pinnacle of the fighting, just as victory was reached. And so these are paintings that follow that tradition of victory being combined with tragedy. And this is, as I said, painted by this American-born artist, John Singleton Copley, who'd seen what West was doing with history painting. Just a couple of years beforehand, he'd had the idea of exhibiting a painting not at the Royal Academy, but on his own, in a separate exhibition space. Because artists were realizing that they were painting these works to be hung at the annual exhibitions of the Royal Academy, but they weren't making direct profits from those. Copley came up with the idea, well, if I have my own show and exhibit my paintings in that individual one-man or one-artist show and charge an admittance fee, I can make money from the admissions, from the people coming to visit. Then people will see the work and they can also subscribe to a print after it. And so that's what he did a number of times, over and over again. He would exhibit a large-scale work that was designed to captivate an audience for a long time. You'd go and watch his paintings like you go to the theatre. They're open in the evening, you'd often look at them by candlelight. People could spend an hour, 2 hours, 3 hours going through these images and looking at them in detail. Certainly a sustained form of looking. So in many ways it was comparable to the kind of spectacle that you might encounter in the theatre. And part of the requirements he realised was to pack his images with details that could be pored over and explored as you spent time looking at the image in front of it. Standing in front of it. And he'd done this with a painting called The Death of Lord Chatham, which is on the left there, which hangs in the National Portrait Gallery. And fantastically, we've got an image of people trooping in to look at this earlier painting of the death of the elder Pitt, the Earl of Chatham, one of the great political leaders of during the Seven Years' War, who collapsed and was to die during a debate, a parliamentary debate, in the House of Lords, just at the time of the American Wars. And so it was seen as especially poignant, this great hero of the Seven Years' War should rise up and die and collapse at the time of this great defeat against America. And here, Copley packs the imagery, packs the painting with hundreds or scores of portraits of parliamentarians of the day, but it centres on, once again, the dying figure of an elderly man in this instance, being cradled and supported by a circle of other men. This time, his sons, actually, and other younger politicians. And you'll see the ways in which people would come into the exhibition. It's a one-painting exhibition. You'd stand in front of it, not in front of the crowd of images that you get at the Royal Academy. And after having looked at it, there's a key. If you look on the left, you see that they're looking at a key to all the portraits, so you can find out, oh yes, that is Lord Mansfield. Oh goodness me, look at whoever it might be. And you're given a key, and then also you were given the opportunity to subscribe to a print. And so you had this whole experience that was a very different way of encountering and consuming art than had previously been the case pre the exhibition era. You paid for it. It was a spectacular commodity. And so he'd done this in 1781 with the Chatham, and he repeats the exercise, this time working in tandem with the print seller, John Boydell, in 1784. And again, we have this fantastic image of people going to look at the painting. And you actually can see on the right-hand side a fragment or a sliver of The Death of Chatham, which he re-exhibited alongside The Death of Pearson. And you can see men and women walking in, leaning on a little balustrade, and staring up and looking at the image, carrying little catalogues or pamphlets in their hand. As I said, you could look at and stare at The Death of Major Pearson, but also then go on and look at the earlier painting of Chatham. It's quite interesting to think of them working side by side. One is all about
a youthful hero, climbing the battlefield.
Pearson was something like 23, very, very young. On the other hand, you have an image of the elderly hero dying in the political arena. But in both cases, they operate both as dramatic contemporary history paintings and as mass group portraits. And I think in many ways they also follow the logic of the sequel. So often you'll know it from films that you've watched, where a successful film will generate a follow-up which has to be slightly more dramatic, slightly more special effects, more people, more thunder and excitement. And that's what seems to have happened here. That one scene, the scene of the death of Jotam, is replaced by one which is far more dramatic, which shows the image when Pearson dies, but is also revenged by the figure of a black servant you see in the middle of the melee, shooting and firing and killing the opponent, the French sniper or soldier who'd killed Pearson. And of course, you see the British flag rising above them all, and in this smoke-filled square in St. Helier in Jersey. And in relation to the kinds of paraphernalia, those pamphlets I mentioned that you were given as you walked in, having paid for your exhibition experience, survive. Here's one of them. This is two sides of the same sheet. So you get a description of the painting as you walked in that you can read as you look at the painting and match up with what you're looking at. And then also you get this fantastic key again to the central group of portraits that you see are distributed across in the foreground of the painting. And it's fascinating. You get the names of all the figures who participated in the battle. Actually, quite accurate, what I found out, that they do represent figures who are there. But it's so interesting, isn't it, that Pearson's black servant, in fact, he didn't have a black servant. That was introduced. Another figure did. It's not given a name. He's simply called Major Pearson's black servant. You can see he's separated out from the group of portrait names of the English army officers who dominate the image. So you would be able to match the imagery to the text on your side. So it's, as I said, a very interesting experience where you're going to this one painting or two paintings show. You've got your pamphlet. You're invited. This is almost like the program to a theatre production, but in fact, where you're given the plot as well. One interesting aspect of it is this very powerful central detail of a figure, an older soldier called Adjutant Harrison, gazing down at the image of the face and the body of Pearson himself. And again, this is an imagery which is in many ways all about the smoke and the thunder of war. But right at its centre, it's got something much more tender and delicate and sensitive. That gaze, that very paternal, sympathetic gaze of the soldier down at the defeated hero. And it's interesting, if you're thinking about imagining experiencing it in the way that those spectators are on the right, you can see that actually what you'd be doing is you'd be looking very close at Pearson yourself. And I think that's quite interesting about the way how you hang it. Because you, in a immense sense, your own engagement with the figure of Pearson, his head, is a kind of echo or a symmetry. There's a symmetrical or symmetry to your own relationship with that head and that of the older man. I remember a student pointing out to me that there's a lovely detail here where that Harrison, the figure who cradles Pearson in his arms, rests Pearson's hand against the scabbard of a sword. So the sword is an emblem both of violence and, of course, of aggression, but here actually used to support the head of the dying Pearson. And Pearson himself is a remarkably painted figure. Let's turn upside down for you. You can see the ways in which he's given, look at this hair and his face, and even smiling at the moment of death. It's a very powerful imagery of youth and of youth caught at the moment of victory, but also it's a very tragic image and very interestingly tender image of between men in the battlefield. Now that image and that exhibition coexisted with another that was taking place pretty much at the same time. They overlapped by a number of weeks. So the death of Major Pearson, Copley's painting, was exhibited in the exhibition season that had emerged in London in the by this time, the 1780s, in which the Royal Academy exhibition itself took place. And that very same year, in 1784, Reynolds returned to military portraiture, which he'd actually abandoned for many years, to exhibit this painting that you see at the centre of the wall of images at the Royal Academy, this painting of the Prince of Wales, owned by Andrew Lloyd Webber today.
The end of the staircase, I've seen it there.
You've seen it there. You've seen it there. So you get all these hundreds of pre-Raphaelite paintings and this painting in his collection. Now, what's fascinating about this is that Reynolds seems to be trying to... Well, he's clearly trying to give the Prince of Wales a heroic identity. But in the newspapers of the day, in every pretty much all media outlets, as we'd say today, he was continually being described as someone who was perpetually drunk, who was a dandy, an extravagant wastrel. He spent most of his time either with prostitutes or with aristocratic women he was having affairs with. So his public image at that time was that of a rake and a dandy and a cad. Someone who also spent huge amounts of money in terms of his own clothing, and famously invented uniforms to wear. So it's fantastic. I read an army historian, or an army a uniform historian, wrote an article about this. You could almost hear him scratching his head and getting frustrated, because this is not a real uniform. This is not a real regimental colours. This is something that the Prince of Wales has made up. But it shows him standing, and it's interesting, this is 1784, the year after the conflict had ended. So, of course, a moment of great disappointment and tragedy and a defeat for Britain. And I think the idea is that both Reynolds and the Prince are hoping that this is an image of reassurance, fortitude. Okay, his father, the King, George III, had supervised an administration that lost the colonies. But under the brave leadership, the new generation of leadership of, God, it sounds like I'm talking about Boris Johnson or something like that. under the new leadership of the Prince of Wales, Britain was going to be reborn as an independent... It was going to be reborn as an independent nation. And what he seems to have done is to model it on an earlier image that he exhibited 2 years before of a painting of a real soldier, Colonel Bannister Tartan, who briefly enjoyed a celebrity in London for his bravery on the battlefield in the American Wars. And this painting was lauded. This is the other painting, by the way, that you get on the other side of the doorway with Orme at the National Gallery, typically. So you walk between these two figures as you walk into that great room with all the turners and constables and so on. And this painting had been exhibited very successfully and enjoyed a lot of appeal. And Prince of Wales kind of seems to have idolised Tartan as the sort of person he would like to be, to kind of projected himself into it. And no doubt in the conversations with Reynolds, he must have said, oh, please paint me as if I was another Tartan. And it's almost as if, indeed, it could be a couple of seconds on from the kind of moment that we see in Tartan's painting, where you can see that Tartan is just about to unsheath the sword from the scabbard and step forward. Well, it's as if that's the sort of moment. You see the horses behind Tartan. It's as if the prince has just dismounted and is facing his enemies. Well, of course, he never stepped anywhere near a battlefield in reality. This is the English countryside. But again, it can symbolically and allegorically even, it could be read as a defence of the British landscape and the British nation by this heroic prince. Even the black clouds behind, of course, are such a typical feature of battlefield paintings. And although they could be the clouds of a thunderstorm over the British landscape, they're just as easily read, almost, again, metaphorically, is referring to the American Wars, and the light is shining and emerging. They'll be banished, and under the great leadership of the Prince of Wales, Britain will be restored to its former vigour, and in fact, it also echoes earlier portraits that he painted during the Seven Years' War, when it had been a much more victorious story. Well, as you can imagine, and I don't know whether you can sort of imagine this even without me telling you any more, it proved the one painting, in many ways, the one portrait that Reynolds exhibited throughout his career that generated universal disdain, contempt and criticism. His normally almost impeccable form in terms of generating successful exhibition paintings certainly failed him here. And in fact, I don't know if you saw this at the top of the stairs, but even the painting of the prince looks like he's made up. It's got like he's got lipstick and rouge and powder, and he looks. And there's some problematic issues. A lot of the critics pulled up about the imagery of his groin and his legs, and it was as if the prince was trying to have it both ways. I'm a kind of virile dandy, and hey, look at me. At the same time, I'm also a responsible figure who can provide a great leader of the future. But as I said, the critics were kind of puzzled because they weren't used to seeing Reynolds fail in this way. So one of them wrote, the face appears swelled and the eyes nearly closed. The figure is by no means graceful, and the left leg in particular is awkwardly disposed of. And he says, the same critic writes, the promise Sir Joshua made in his portrait of Colonel Tarleton is badly kept by his performance in the prints. And others talked in similar ways about the ways in which this was an ungraceful, gaudy, extravagant painting, in which the lack of fit between this imagery and the prince's public reputation was just too grotesque and too obvious for it to do its kind of ideological pictorial work. So I think that, at the same time, it can't have helped that just across the way in London, the imagery of a true hero, a true youthful hero of the kind that George, the Prince of Wales, would have aspired to be seen in relation to, was on display. And it's quite interesting to compare and think about these two very different military portraits hanging simultaneously in London's exhibition culture in the summer of 1784. 1780s, as I said, the late 1780s was a moment in which Britain had to come to terms with the defeat of the colony and the loss of the colonies. And what we seem to see emerging in that period is a new, more melancholic imagery of the soldier, at least in moments. And this is a remarkable painting by Joseph Wright of Derby, which was exhibited, I think, in 1789. I think it was 1789 at the Royal Academy exhibition. And this actually draws on a poem that had recently been published, which actually referred back to the Seven Years' War, but rather than focusing on the heroic narratives of the Seven Years' War, which so many other artists had done, it's a poem by John Langhorne called The Country Justice. It actually focused on the death of an ordinary soldier in the landscape and his abandonment, essentially, by the British and by the British Army, and the fact that this left this widow and child forlorn and helpless following their husband and their father's death. And Wright of Derby, who was always so inventive and so fascinated with this imagery of melancholy and darkness and solitude, produces and then exhibits this astonishing painting, a number of versions of which exist, which shows an ordinary soldier having died, being mourned over by his widow, and then whose dead hand is being held, the fingers of which are held by his child, and this macabre, odd detail. And the child looks out at us. And it's interesting, with the Copley painting of Pearson, the only figure who looks out directly at the spectator is the child that runs away on the right. And here, that idea of a moment in the image, or a little where that the kind of the fourth wall is punctured by the outward gaze of a figure, is here taken up with a child. And as I was putting this lecture together, I got quite intrigued again by this painting. And the ways in which, in some ways, and in relation to the series, you know, we've looked at paintings like the one on the left. Remember Lydia talking about the paintings of Marlborough's victories. And we did see that in the earlier imagery of war, you did find these scattered bodies. But typically they would be juxtaposed with and overwhelmed by the imagery of the heroic general. Even in the Copley, you'll see on the right-hand side, right next to that fleeing figure of the child looks out, a fallen soldier. But it's very unusual in the way that Wright does to focus on that figure himself. And he strips, rather than being a great general or a dashing officer, he's stripped of rank. He's an everyman. And of course, we don't see his face, and we don't see her face either. So it's a kind of anti-portrait, rather than a portrait. And it asks us to imagine their expressions, and in doing so, gives them, I think, a greater resonance and tragedy. It's really fascinating to compare it with the Wolf painting, which was so famous in this period. It's almost the reversal of Wolf. Although, again, I was just 5 minutes before I walked in for the lecture tonight, I was just looking at the ways in which you get this echo of the hands cradling the arm. It's a fascinating kind of chain of hand gestures. And look at the way in which the widow's hand cradles the baby's head in a way that's quite similar to the cradling of the general's arm by one of his fellow soldiers. But this is very different. And look, that's a group portrait. We see all their faces. We see all their expressions. In Wright's painting, that's turned away. We have to imagine that. And it's an old device, a fascinating, actually that idea of not showing a face and giving extra tragedy to your image or power to your image by not showing the expression, inviting the spectator to imagine that expression and the tragedy and that grief that it might be carrying, goes back to antiquity, famously used by Poussin in his painting of the death of Germanicus, where you see Germanicus dying and his wife, soon to be a widow, covering her face so she doesn't show her expression, but it also means that we can't do it. And so this is a really revolutionary painting, I think, in many ways, a really radical painting by Wright of Derby, which on the one hand follows in the footsteps of all those dead soldiers in the landscape paintings that we've been looking at, and yet turns the conventions of that genre on its head. I'm going to finish by looking at the exhibition of 1822. And soon after Waterloo, of course, just a few years after Waterloo and the great victory at Waterloo. And this painting was the painting of that year at the Royal Academy Exhibition. Wilkie's painting commissioned by the victor at Waterloo, the Duke of Wellington, and showing a whole nation, as it were, in microcosm, celebrating the moment of victory. And it shows an old soldier. You see him holding the newspaper, and described in the descriptive commentary on this painting as a veteran of the 7 Years' War. So it's interesting, this painting takes us right back to the start of our lecture and that earlier conflict. And this veteran of the 7 Years' War reads out the news of this new great victory at Waterloo to an assembled gathering that includes soldiers both from other conflicts, other veterans, and as well as contemporary soldiers, Chelsea pensioners, in this sunlit scene in which, for the most part, there's great joy and jubilation about the news. And you see here figures on the right of a bit of a man-spreading male figure holding up the baby, celebrating with his wife, and a whole group of jubilant figures who are hearing for the first time the news that has come about this great victory. There's one moment of real poignancy in this painting which is fascinating, is that you can just see over the lid or upper edge of the newspaper, you see the half a face of a woman, I think holding a baby, and she's scanning the list of the dead in the newspaper. And that was, Wilkie described it as doing that, hoping against hope that she doesn't see the name of her husband in the list of the dead. But otherwise, this is very much an imagery of celebration. And it dominated the exhibition of 1872. It was great, very much the exclamatory painting of the whole exhibition. It's interesting, look, three exclamation marks at the end of this title. And the painting itself had that sort of power. It had an exclamatory power in the exhibition space in 22. And not far away from it, actually, and again, I mean, this is a very elaborate and complex form of propaganda in so many ways, of course, hung a portrait by Thomas Lawrence of the Duke of Wellington himself. So the combination of these images and that association of this great victory with this contemporary hero was made complete, at least in the dialogue between these images in the exhibition space. But what's fascinating, in the same exhibition is a painting that I think is, in so many ways, although much simpler, just as, if not more complex than Wilkie's. It's a painting by William Mulready called The Convalescent. And this shows someone who is a convalescent, a veteran from Waterloo, and rather than showing him in a heroic guise or an exclamatory guise, it's a much more modest and I'm not sure how best to describe it, a painting that's got real pathos and weight. And it shows a veteran as if still holding his torso in pain or in reassurance, holding the hand of his wife. It's a very mournful sense to the way in which he's sitting there with his wife. And then also look at the way in which his leg is being wrapped by, encircled by the arms of his daughter. This is a veteran to be respected, but not someone who's been glorified as a great hero. I think look at the trees, the fallen trees on which he sits and that litter the landscape. I think unmistakably meant to offer an echo of all the fallen bodies at Waterloo. And there was a counter narrative about Waterloo, which was very much about the fact that as much as it had been a great victory, that left a battlefield littered with corpses. Turner famously painted the field at Waterloo littered with corpses. And there's an amazing exchange, I think, between the figure of the father or the soldier as he looks across at his two sons fighting. On the one reading, you can read this very much as, well, I've suffered for my country to enable them to flourish, to play, to fight. They've got all the virility and the energy and the British vigour that we'll need in future. But there's also something, I think, much sadder about another side to his gaze across. And it's interesting to imagine they're at a beach by the sea. He knows what lies across that sea. He knows what lies on the fields of Waterloo. And it's as if what Mull really wants to conjure up the sense that he, in looking at his sons, he's also remembering the fighting that he saw in the battlefield at Waterloo. And he look, when he think, remembers that, he doesn't remember it necessarily positively or optimistically or heroically. He remembers it sadly. And this, all of this seems to be mixed together in this image. It's an image of, it's meant to be a kind of a quietly heroic image of this convalescent, of this veteran, but I think it's also an image that's meant to suggest kind of the tragedy and the pity and the aftermath and the consequences of war, the painful consequences of war. And there's a wonderful critic who wrote in the early 19th century who's I've come to really admire, and I'd love to read much more of his work, one of the best art critics of the early 19th century, Robert Hunt. And he described, in his review of this painting, he said it was a remarkable painting. And he talked about the smile on the soldier's pale face. He uses that phrase, pale face, as he looks at his boys. And he wrote that this smile was like, this is his quote, like faint sunshine on dreary snow. Oh, that is just perfect, I think, in terms of capturing that sense of faint sunshine on dreary snow, that sense of complexity and mixed feelings that someone like in his situation had about the conflict. And just imagine this hanging not far away from that Wilkie painting or that Lawrence portrait of Wellington. You can see that in the Royal Academy exhibitions of the time, both the heroism but also the tragedy of war was being negotiated in really interesting ways by Britain's most interesting artists. Thank you very much.